Good morning. The next time your GPS tells you to take a right, take a left. Just do it. Do it even though everything tells you not to, including that annoying nasal voice on the GPS. Do it. You may get a little lost, but chances are you'll find something. Something that you didn't even know existed. That's what my roadmap for my life has been. And it's not something I've done in a rebellious manner. It's something I've done with one small device to guide me. My gut, my intuition. Intuition is something we tend to ignore because we don't trust ourselves enough. We don't listen to the voice inside our heads. Instead, we listen to the world. How will they react? What will they say? What if they don't approve? We create feelings of self-doubt, feelings that paralyze us and force us to stay in our safe zone, our comfort zone. We forget that we have one life. And this day, this moment, comes in that life only once. So it's far too precious for us to spend it being afraid. Sometimes the first step, and that's all it takes, the first step to achieving your dream is really just as simple as saying it out loud. Saying it out loud. Believing that you are the dream. 7 years ago, I said it out loud. I said, I am a musician. And you know, everything changed. My life changed. And today I can finally say I am home. I quit everything to follow my dream. I quit my advertising job after training to be a graphic designer for 4 years in the Delhi College of Art, a job I loved and I was doing really well at. When I joined advertising as a graphic designer, I wanted to be at the beginning of the ideation process, but unfortunately in those days, art directors didn't get to be at the beginning of the birth of the idea. They couldn't create it, they could only execute an idea that a copywriter wrote. So I had the gift of the gab and I managed to talk my boss into letting me write my own ads. But you know what this did? This confused people because I didn't fit neatly into one slot or the other. People love to categorize you, you know? They like to label you. Anyone who sort of breaks the boundaries, is a little bit out of the ordinary, makes them uncomfortable. Anyway, so when I did what I wanted to do, I became a writer after being in advertising for 4 years, training to be in College of Art, and I trained to be a graphic designer. Everyone was very surprised when I'd finally been doing what I wanted to do, but I quit. I had been studying music while I was in advertising, but the long hours never gave me enough time to do it justice. And I had been thinking about it for a while, but it was just one fine day that I was sitting in my computer and I thought, this is it. I have to jump off the deep end now or I'm never going to do it. And I quit. It was not meant to be dramatic. It was at the turn of the millennium, but I did it. And I thought initially that, you know, I'll play it a little safe. I'll take 3 months off and I'll see what happens, but I never looked back. It wasn't easy. When I quit, I lost my voice, and I quit to study music, so I lost my voice after quitting for 1 year. I got laryngitis, pharyngitis, you name it, every throat infection in the world I got. But I didn't give up. I worked in television, I broadened my horizons, I said I will experience life. I freelanced, I did everything that came my way, I decided to be a sponge and absorb life, until I was better and able to resume singing. 3 years later, my mother was detected with stage 4 lung cancer, something that breaks my heart even now. She was my backbone, my strength, my best friend. She was the strongest woman I know, and we were told when she was detected that she had 4 months to live, but she decided that she was going to prove the world wrong and prove the doctors wrong, and she did. A year of radiation, chemotherapy, alternative medicine later, I felt I needed a vent because it had been such a hard year. So I started theater. I couldn't sing. My heart was so broken. But theater healed me. It also taught me so much. It taught me one of the most valuable and most important lessons of my life. It taught me that as long as there is truth in the moment, even if there is imperfection, there will be beauty. And it taught me to stop worrying so much about perfection, about failure, about success, and spend more time in the search of truth, in the search of my truth, in the search of our truths. Even though I was fortunate enough to study Indian classical music as a child from teachers anyone would have given their lives to learn from, I think the reason I did so much else and it took me so long to come back to music was because I wanted to have something relevant to say with the music, something that I needed to say, my story, my truth. One of my gurus told me, she said, to be able to sing, you have to have lived. And I didn't understand it then, but I do now. I have lived through the 84 riots, where we were targeted only because we belong to the Sikh religion. I lived through the violence, the fear, the hatred, the not understanding why we were made to feel different just because of the label Sikh. Because one person, irrespective of which religion he belonged to, had done something. I have lived through the tsunami where, in Sri Lanka, where my husband and I held onto a pillar for dear life, we had the water over our heads, and we watched people get washed away around us. I have lived through the miracle of my father surviving an illness where every organ had failed and the doctors had given up, and it was just faith that brought him back. And I have lived through the hardest of them all, losing both my parents far too early. Through all of this, I've lived through questioning God, questioning belief, questioning religion, and how it's supposed to unite, yet it divides us. I have lived through forgiving, learning, letting go, and finding through this entire process a different understanding of it all, of faith, of belief in people, in God, and in finding God within people, in finding goodness within people, in celebrating life and love. So as I said to you, I did finally have something to say, and it was called the Sufi Gospel Project. It's my story, it's our story. I have on my left Ehsan and on my right Tarit, and we've worked together to create this. So these are the co-authors of my story, and I am the co-author of theirs. The Sufi Gospel Project is an attempt to blend the many voices of faith and create one voice. It's an attempt to break down the walls that separate us, remove the labels that we use to create distinctions between us. Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Christian, Buddhist, man, woman, straight, gay. Why do we need these labels? Just so that we can be put into little boxes so that the other person can say, oh, he's like that or she's like this. The Sufi Gospel Project is about questioning our differences, but through them, finding our similarities. It's about realizing that each of us has our own truth, but that each truth can be and is just as valid. And if we were to stop and listen carefully, we might realize we are all saying the same thing, but in different ways. The idea had been germinating in my head for a while, but really, I think it was something that was gifted to me by the universe, by God, when I was asked to sing gospel at the birth centenary of the Sufi saint Inayat Khan Nizamuddin. The thought of a Sikh girl singing Christian music, gospel music, in a seemingly Islamic space, that just blew my mind, and I thought, I have to do something befitting of this opportunity. I had been singing gospel music for many years, even though I'd trained in Indian classical music, and as it is, that really confused the label Walas, because everybody thought, why is a Sikh girl singing Christian music? What's wrong with her? Christian bhajans, as someone called them. You know, I think that that's probably what spurred me on. The fact that I was causing this discomfort, this confusion to all those people who wanted to box and slot me. So I would just look at them when they'd say, why do you sing Christian bhajans? I would say, because God and faith have no religion. Sufism means an acceptance of all humanity. Gospel means the truth. Sufi means pure. So there are so many similarities. Once I started looking, I realized the similarities. And so that's what this project is about. It's an acceptance of all truths, yours, mine, his, hers, everyone's truth as equal. I found resonances of this acceptance, of this truth of acceptance everywhere I looked, not just in ancient texts, but in contemporary voices across the world. I found them across times. I could find something that Rumi had said, and I would find a resonance of it in Kabir Das. I would find something that Leonard Cohen had said in Hallelujah, And I would find a resonance of it in the words of Rabia al-Basri from centuries ago. I found it in the bhakti tradition, in music and voices from all over the world, in chants, in a couplet my mother wrote. She wrote a beautiful couplet which I found after she passed away, and it said, Guru mere saath khade hain, Gobind yahi to hain, Allah bhi maujood hai yahan, to kaun kahan se hai? So the Sufi Gospel Project, in creating the Sufi Gospel Project, and I'll have you know, three people sitting on this stage all belong to different religions. Ehsan is Muslim. I belong to the Sikh religion. Tarit is a Hindu. And we all came together to create this. And it freed each one of us because we were able to break preconceived notions of what can or what should be. We were able to let one thought flow seamlessly into the other, guided by intuition, actually guided by intellect perhaps, but always led by intuition. And it was straight from the heart always. Whenever we felt something just flowed naturally, we went with it. So the music of the Sufi Gospel Project is about faith, not just in God, but in good. In people, it's about standing up for equality of gender, of acceptance, of tolerance, unity, secularism, and individuality. And every time we get on that stage, get onto any stage, we realize yet another simple truth, that the music of the Sufi Gospel Project is not only my story, it's not only their stories, but it's the story of you, it's the story of them, it's the story of many voices, many thoughts, many truths, but most importantly, it's an acceptance of every voice. We would like to leave you with the words of the poet Faiz Ahmed Faiz, and this is another thing, we just came back from Pakistan, where we had the honor of being able to sing the poetry of one of their most famous poets. And Faiz Sahab was such an incredible poet. He spoke against oppression. He spoke for equality. He gave his life for that. And that, as I said, I found resonances everywhere. And in these words, they ring so true. He says, Bol ke lab azad hain tere. Bol zaban ab tak teri hai. Tera sutva jism hai tera, bol ke ja ab tak teri hai. Speak because your lips, they are still free. Speak because your tongue, it is still your own. Your body is your own. Your life is still your own. And no change can come unless we speak out. We need to ask for what we want. We need to speak out for equality, gender, equality, we need to speak out for justice towards people, towards women, towards animals. We need to use our voices. In this day, in this digital era, we have the advantage of being able to use our voices and of being heard. So let's pledge today, when you'll be hearing many voices, let's pledge together that we will use our voice and the power of our collective voices to spread this message of acceptance, of oneness, of tolerance, and let's use our voices to make a change.
बोल के लब आजाद हैं तेरे बोल ज़बां अब तक तेरी है तेरा सुतवा जिस्म है तेरा बोल के जा अब तक तेरी है बोल के लब आजाद है तेरे बोल ज़बान अब तक तेरी है, तेरा सुतवा जिस्म है तेरा, बोल के जा अब तक तेरी है। देख के आहंगर की दुकान में तुंद है शोले, सुर्ख है आहन, खुलने लगे कुफलों जिस्मों ज़बान की मौत से पहले, बोल के सच जिंदा है अब तक, बोल जो कुछ कहना है कह ले। मौत से पहले बोल के सच जिंदा है अब तक, बोल जो कुछ कहना है कह ले।
Yeah.
Thank you.